My name's Jemma Redgrave, and the name of my monologue is Rosa, and the character I'm playing is Dr. Rosa Hamilton. She is she specializes in geriatrics, and she looks after for a local area health board, a group of care homes. She looks after all the elderly residents of the care homes. Fairly large number of people, yeah. She's been in this job for a long time, and she is, I hate this word, but passionate about. She's committed is what she is. She's deeply committed to the people that she looks after and to the work that she does. But over the years, battling an inhumane at best and brutal system at worst, she's been worn down by the sheer volume and the weight of hopelessness, really, and the despair she encounters on a regular basis. And she is beginning to lose her sense of, she's beginning to lose her zeal to make a difference to these people. And that in itself is beginning to undermine her sense of self, I think. I think she's the most wonderful woman, and my heart breaks for her, because we can all see, can't we, on a daily basis right now at this very moment in time, people working in hospitals battling for the equipment that they desperately need, for the provisions that they desperately need to look after the people that they want to save. It feels absolutely, I can't believe it was written 40 years ago. And in a way, it's absolutely dreadful. I mean, it's a tragedy that it was written 40 years ago, because it could have been written, give or take the odd reference, to sexual politics, and which have moved on somewhat, but it could have been written now. It's a delicate balance between in her case, it's not an internal monologue. In her case, it is. She's not speaking her thoughts. It's not like a Shakespearean monologue. It was written to be spoken. It was written to, she said, she's sending a message to her local authority, but really it's the fantasy message she would like to send. And in the end, it's the message she can't send. So, but her thought process is very, she jumps very fast. It's the turn of a sixpence between rage and despair and irony and humour and the opposite of those things, yeah. Oh, well, the last time I was on stage was, when did the first lockdown end? Was it July, August? July, I think. I went to the Stephen Joseph Theatre in Scarborough. They were doing rehearsed readings, and we rehearsed on Zoom. There's a two-hander, absolutely marvellous play called Hansard. Do you know it? Yeah, isn't it brilliant? Performed it just for one night, with a socially distanced audience. There was a Q&A afterwards, and in my experience of Q&As in the theatre, a lot of people leave, a few people stay, every single person stayed, and it was, don't bang the mic. It was incredibly moving to be in an audience with a group of people, and it wasn't really a Q&A. We discussed the play. We talked about how we felt about it. We talked about, the audience talked about how it might have been done differently, or how they would see it, you know, how it would be with a set, and what would be gained and what would be lost. And it was just wonderful. Before that, I can't remember. Before that, I was sitting in, I went to in March, before the first lockdown, last time I was in a theatre, I went to the Lyric Hammersmith. Well, they're marvellous pieces of writing. I think they stand up. It doesn't surprise me that some of the greatest actors of their generation 40 years ago wanted to play these on radio. Because, and you're going to tell me who played this, don't tell me now. Not on camera. like the Wicked Witch of the West, I'll just melt into a puddle of horror on the floor. They're brilliant, brilliant pieces of writing. I didn't know them before, and I'm so, so glad that I've been introduced to them. And I'm so, so, I can't tell you, so happy to be in this beautiful theatre on this stage.